How can, how do they have solidarity with this colonial state that is based on the ruins of the Palestinian homeland? This is the subject of this event. And as Asma mentioned, we have four renowned researchers. We start with the first intervention presented by Doctor, no, not doctor. He is not a doctor. Mr. Khalid Audatullah. I was speaking to him. We have a name with the same family, Audatullah, but he called Audatullah. Anyway, he's Mr. Khalid will make a presentation titled Chronicling the Zionist Military History of World War II and the Recruitment of Colonial Solidarity with Israel. Khalid is a researcher in the military history and historical geography of Palestine. Each speaker and presenter will be given some time between 12 to 15 minutes. Then we'll open the floor for questions or commenting the intervention. Mr. Khalid, the floor is yours. Good evening, everyone, and thanks a lot for inviting us and for the nice introduction. And I hope that within my introduction, I can provide something new. As mentioned, this is a very long title of the event, of the presentation. But I'm trying to make it shorter to express the content of the intervention. I'll speak intensively about the Zionist military history in World War I in Palestine and how this history writing, how is it used to create the colonial solidarity with the so-called Israel. And in order not to keep it general, I'll take a case study, which is a Zionist organization or calls itself the World War I heritage in the so-called Land of Israel as a case study. Before I start with some introductions, I think always when we speak about solidarity with the so-called Israel all the time, we go to the area of international politics and geopolitics and all these big names and colonial interests that at the start created Israel, then created this state of incubation or support for this entity called Israel. And many times we ignore the partial dimension for this solidarity. That is the certain cases that create solidarity. The important thing in this intervention that we will shed light on solidarity with Israel at the popular level and not only at the government level. So in my view, this complements what is usually absented in our discussion about solidarity with the so-called Israel. Okay, a short introduction to the heritage society, the World War I heritage society in the Land of Israel. This is a Zionist organization. The Society for the Heritage of World War I. It was established in 2001 by those interested in the history of World War I and Palestine, especially the military dimension and its operations. I'm sure you know that during the First World War I in Palestine, it is even absented in the Palestinian history research. There is a great gap in covering the military operations during the war. There are some writings about the social history in the late era of the British Mandate, but the military operations, there is a complete absenting of them. Although World War I in Palestine lasted for around 3 years in operations, was very slow and covered all of Palestine. And in all the writings of official history in World War I in Palestine, there is a great presence of Palestinian geography in that history with its villages and all the details of its geography. Okay, this society was established as a voluntary initiative by those interested in the heritage of World War I in Palestine. And it's not a coincidence that those interested people are residents of Beer Seba city or area. And for those who know about the war there at that time, the British mandate that caused a breach into the Ottoman defenses there led to the collapse of Ottoman's defenses in Palestine and later on occupation of Palestine. And let's remember that the Balfour Declaration is the declaration that was written and issued by the British Ministry of Defense. At that time, Wiseman was in the British cabinet, and he was told from Mr. Sykes to Mr. Wiseman, it's a boy that Balfour Declaration has been agreed upon, and it was issued after 2 or 3 days. This society conducts a number of activities to educate around the heritage of World War I. I'm speaking about detailed writing, and this society has this logo of British Imperial camel riding soldiers. There is a specialty for this because it was established and ended in line with the operations in Palestine, with the end of it 1916 until the end of the operations near the Syrian borders until it was resolved there. So there's something imperialist in this logo and using it as a logo for the society. There are long discussions. This is Lawrence and there are here indications for using this logo from Lawrence's photograph. And here there's an important issue that these historians, some of them professionals, some amateurs and researchers, a wide variety of researchers, simply said that the events of World War I, the important ones from the history of the so-called Israel, are absent from the Zionist awareness and need someone to do so. That is, to educate the Zionist society around the events of this war. Here is the first comment, is that in the Zionist history that prevailed in the World War I history, war is part of the Zionist narrative. So the war is part of the development and evolution of events that led to reviving the Zionist project in Palestine, but not that the World War as the one which basically produced the so-called state of Israel through the meeting of imperialist interests with that of the Zionists. There are several discussions that coincided with the establishment of this society due to its importance for the Zionist memory and the need to enrich the library, especially the military one, about the events of World War I in Palestine. The Israeli army played an important role here because the literature in Hebrew were almost absent, so they translated many of these literature especially about the military aspect literature into Hebrew. The other comment, which is important for our context, although the work of the society was classified under military history, which is part of the history that focuses mainly in narrating the details of military operations with their different dimensions, the firearms, the topography, whatever. But in the Zionist experience, there is a speciality for the military history, which is related to the establishment of armed Zionist militia and later on the Israeli army, which is was called later on the Moreshet Krak in Hebrew, meaning that military history is not just narrating the events, just to narrate them, to tell them, but in terms of their value for reviving heroism, if you wish, there. And here I brought a number of writings by this society. This is just a sample. This is the number of research issued around in a study day. Now they have 15 study days. Like, as you see, the development of military operations in Negev and Sinai and near Jerusalem and so forth. The important here is that we say that this society dates or writes the history of war as some scientific history, but uses the Zionist version in turning the events of the war into events that make components for the colonial Zionist entity. So it's not just for knowledge. He's left with 5 minutes. That's why you see during in one of the research, they listed the number of British soldiers who were awarded a trophy or the Queen Victoria trophy. And you see Netanyahu on the first 100th anniversary of Be'er Sabah battle, speaking to the soldiers as Be'er Sheva battle was a minority 800 Australian knights against the 4,000 Turkish soldiers, although these are historically wrong. The same Zionist experience has been minority facing the majority. Later on, even the Zionist historians refuted that. Where the Zionist imperialism met with the Zionist one as the war developed. When the British soldiers, Indian, New Zealanders, Nepalese, and Australians, when they started meeting with the first Zionist settlements in Palestine, they were established in 1880, for instance. The first settlement they met was the Gadera, and later on Rehovot and Deir Diran and Betzilona and other settlements. At that time, the imperial soldiers felt that what they missed in the form of buildings, like their home, they felt at home with the shape of cities and buildings. They start seeing that these red tile roofs similar to their houses. Later on, this turned into a part of the propaganda that Jabotinsky used in 1917 when writing about making wine in Lichon, Etzion, to show how much the Zionist project is a Western one, and a Western one in the land of in an oriental part or eastern part. And now when they speak about occupation of Jerusalem in the official history, they call it liberation of Jerusalem. They use the same imperialist slogans and terminologies that the so-called liberation of Jerusalem is a milestone in turning the city from being backward into modernity and so forth. Now, all of this, how this was turned into practices, this society revives and contributes to reviving and celebrating all the occasions related to World War I in Palestine. Here, this is the celebration annually on November 11th every year at 11 a.m. Mark the memory of the British soldiers, and this is a British event in Lifta, Mount Scopus, beside the Hebrew University, as a remembrance day. Here, there is a use of military topography, or what's remained of trenches in defending Jerusalem and connecting the battle with the Balfour Declaration. The battle was to achieve the Balfour promise or declaration. Another issue, which I called it family tensions, which is imperialist one. Under the British imperialism in Palestine, all the nations met here. Like we had South Africa, Nepal, Australia, New Zealand, Indians. All the nations fought here under the flag of the British. But later on, these countries turned into independent countries, such as the Maharaja flag. Now they became independent. So the Zionists rewrote the military history of the military operations in terms of participants, not as being soldiers to imperialism, but as soldiers in the settlements. Here there is a study day and a remembrance mausoleum for the Indian soldiers who fought at Megiddo battle. This is the military attache in Tel Aviv. Here also, this is in Azzoun, where the events by the imperialist Indian soldiers. Again, this is Ra'anana mayor, and this is the Indian ambassador in Tel Aviv. Same thing for Nepal. Nepalese soldiers under the British imperialism fought in Palestine. So in the celebrations of relation between Nepal and Israel, there is a book here cover in remembrance. The Zionist head of the society wrote the history of Nepalese soldiers as being main actors in war against Palestine. Can I get 2 minutes, please? Okay. This is in the celebration that happened for 2 months in Samakh near Tiberia. This was the last battle before Jisr Banat Yaqub battle, which was the last battle in Palestine. And what's interesting here is the
اللي هو إعادة الاعتبار
refocusing on the history of indigenous Australian Australians who are victims to the Australian colonialism. Here they are reacting the battle and all of this, all these turned into the friends of Israel while they are indigenous. There is no logic here. Also, I return here to a very short comment, and we can complete in the discussion later on. The Armenian massacres used here is the head of the city and the Armenian patriarchy. They use the memory of Arara battle, where dozens of Armenian soldiers who volunteered to fight the Ottomans with the imperial soldiers, they are used to make similarities that Jabotinsky brought. During the World War I in Palestine, Jamal Pasha issued the first order to evacuate the Yaffa and Tel Aviv citizens, and they faced that evacuation with the Armenian massacre in 1917. So until this day, they use the massacre as a tool to create solidarity between the victims, in brackets, victims of World War I, that the Zionists are not only benefited from this war, but also they have the narrative of victims similar to the Armenians as happened during the World War I. To sum up, and later on we can complete this, at least there are two dimensions for this use of military history. The first one, creating or reviving connections with the official institutions with the different countries. And the second one, which is extremely important, is to work at the popular level, not only at the official one, in terms of the descendants of those who were killed here in the country to see their grandfathers where they were killed. This society brings them as being they are the host and to show them where the battle, based on the records, your grandfather was killed here, they would plant a tree and say, long live Israel, and that's it. Thank you. Thank you, Khaled. I know the subject is requires longer time, but we are very limited in time. Now, we move to the next intervention, which is Mr. Omar Al-Ghabari. Omar Al-Ghabari. Omar Al-Ghabari. He writes in the issues of Nakba and Right to Return, and he's a guide to the evacuated Palestinian village. His subject is creating solidarity with Zionism through delusion, deception, realism, and inspiration, the role of the Jewish National Fund as a model, which is called in Hebrew Keren Kayemet, the Jewish National Fund. It has a, plays a major role and taking over the Palestinian territory, and recently they extended their activity to 1967 territories. In the past, their activity was limited to 1948, but in recent years, they extended their activity to include the 1967 territory. And defining this fund defines itself as, since buying the first spaces of the land, the fund is working in the name on behalf of the Jewish people and for them, entrusted by them for their land in Israel. What the fund has done over the early decades was established in 1901. What it did is the one that demarcated the border of Israel, and as part of what it did, These sentences are the fingerprints of the fund. Is there more than 1,000 villages across Israel, be it through buying land or rehabilitating it? The fund has bought more than 2.6 million dunams for settlement and prepared the land for building around 1,000 settlements across the country. Mr. Omar, the floor is yours. Thank you. You have spoiled half of my intervention. You have mentioned half of it. Okay, good evening. Thank you for the invitation and for this important event. I will try to discuss the subject of solidarity, which the Zionist movement succeeded in forming. The Jewish National Fund is one of the tools of the Zionist movement, which I will prove this at the end of the presentation. All of the intervention will conclude that in the Zionist movement in general and the Jewish National Fund in particular, there is a success in creating a mixture of different similar things. First, at the practical level, mixing between the official and public, popular. They did not spare any single opportunity to get official support and solidarity since it was established, and also worked hard to mobilize popular solidarity, starting between the Jews across the world, and it succeeded elsewhere. And if succeeded elsewhere also, this would be better. The second blend is between the past and the present, and maybe the future. Between the old and the new, the modern and the old, the present and the future, and the Zionist thought by Herzl, who spoke about building the Jewish state, which he wrote in his book, Altoland, this is in German, the old new land, where he mixed between what is old and new, and mixed between what is religious and modern. All of this, I call it as a blend that is evident sometimes in the literature of the Zionists, where there are conflicts in the history of the Zionist movement until this day. The best that Israel succeeded in is that to be the aggressor, but depicting itself as a victim. This duality is difficult to promote it to the world, but unfortunately, Israel is succeeding in that. By the way, even when Herzl's book was translated to Hebrew, Tel Aviv. Tel is old and Aviv is the new. This is how they translated it into Hebrew. And from here came the name of Tel Aviv. So, with the advent of the Zionist movement, their success in attracting solidarity, especially at the official level at that period of time, I say that was easy for them because the Zionist movement was established under a European atmosphere, if you wish. Its founders are part of the European white man, which is natural for them, the imperial movements in Africa and Asia. So it was not something strange or was natural for them. So when the Zionist movement came up with the idea of establishing the so-called home or international community for Jews in one place, it's very similar to every colonial movement carried out by Britain, Netherlands, Portugal in very recent years in the 18th century. So this was very acceptable to their leaders at that time. So it was easy for the Zionist movement to convince the governments and leadership with this. At the same time, the Zionist movement with its literature, early literature, it didn't feel ashamed as saying that it used the term colonial in Latin and in English. They used the term, colonial in their literature. They are using colonialism and dealing with the indigenous people in the country that will be colonized is dealing with the with supremacy over the indigenous people. We know the Zionist movement started by giving ideas where this state, Jewish state, can be established. And Palestine came in a later stage. At the start, they proposed Uganda, Argentina, and Sinai, and later on, the idea that gave it more probability was Palestine, because here they mixed between the religious and colonialist, and the religious was became more Zionistized, if you wish, and so the proportional percentage of success of the idea was attained. So the leaders of the Zionist movement, the early ones, said, wrote several issues as for the Palestinians and Arabs. And the quote that is here from Palmang Bomankin is one of the early leaders of the Zionist movement and a businessman, and tried to take over land in Palestine. And in Hebrew, that dealing or handling the backward or ignorant Arabs is that they will be subjected to the colonizer in a strange way. That is, they will be subjected with love and respect for the European, Ashkenaz, Western colonizers. Herzl's book on the Jewish state, he said, we will be in Asia as a preventive wall preventing the barbarians from going to Europe. So Israel will have a colonial job or role to protect civilization in Europe against the barbaric citizens in that land. This thought was translated completely in Balfour Declaration. The first draft was written by Lord Rothschild before Balfour himself wrote it. He got the draft from him and simply amended it. And here are the points that have complete reflection with the Zionist thoughts. Colonial one, 2 points to mention in this terrific text. First, it deals with the Jews as a nation because they want to establish a homeland for the Jewish people or nation, but it deals with the Palestinians as non-Jewish communities, as they did not exist, just non-Jewish communities. The second thing, the Jews have political and national rights in this homeland. For those non-Jews, there are civil and religious rights. Those who remember the Jewish, the nationalism law, the nationality law in 2018 was very similar to this in Israel, that law in Israel. So what is more dangerous
بأنه وأنا كمان مرة يبدو في عربي هون.
There is some Arabic here.
طيب مش مبين عندك بسيطة.
Another quote.
على اليمين. أوكي. تمام. موجود.
It says Zionism, be it right or wrongful, good or bad, it is entrenched in old beliefs and the needs of the present and the hopes for the future. See how he's connecting the past, the present, and the future. And he says, all of the most important thing is, without comparison, these are more important of what the 700,000 Arab Palestinians who live in that old land. The Palestinian Jews were less than 70,000, but he dealt with them as a nation, but did not deal with the Palestinians as a nation. The second thing that assisted the Zionist movement for to be accepted by regular people is the Zionist propaganda saying that this was a vacant land. And as Mr. Antoine mentioned, that the Zionists are not ignorant or naive. They saw the Palestinians, but they dealt with them as creatures walking on the land, but not as a nation that deserves to be called a nation. And so, this myth is reflected in the Zionist literature and writing and media at that time, and sometimes in technical issues. This drawing, I use it when we make tours at Al Manshiya in Yafa. The one to the right, written by Nahman Gutman in the 80s, when Jewish neighborhoods were built near Yafa. And he drew the area from early of Tel Aviv, early days, the beginning of houses in Tel Aviv. And at the end, you see St. Peter's Church Tower, and between them, it is vacant. As per the drawing. But look at the picture to the right, what was there. He saw the houses, but he decided to draw them and to paint them as if it is empty. Although Al-Manshiya neighborhood was there. Look at the left, there is the tower of the church, is the same as in his painting. In a very painful, sarcastic way, is the photograph to the right as if they evacuated the land in a deliberate way. The other thing is making Zionists the religious factors and taking them over to convince the Jews that the Zionist project is a correct one to serve the Jews. And they started printing stamps, postal stamps, and publishing in the Jewish magazines in the end of the 19th century and early 20th century, as if the land is vacant and waiting for you, Jews of the world, to the right. Come on to the land. Come and take over the land. Inherited from your ancestors. 5 minutes, but I will increase them to you. So the Jewish factor is yearning to the Holy Land. The Jewish religion across the years dealt with this as something theological, but and not as something that humans can achieve. But the Zionist movement came and said, we are here to salvage and redeem the Jewish homeland. So they translated this Jewish belief into an action political program, and the Jewish Fund, as mentioned, played an important decisive role in realizing that dream and depicted itself with the Zionist movement in general as redeeming or salvaging the Jewish people.
الأمر الثاني اللي نجحت الحرب
الإقناع
اليهودي الشخص اليهودي به هو
is building the new Jew.
هم إنه بدنا نتخلص من عقلية وهوية اليهودية المنفى اليهود في المنافع
the mentality of the Jews like when the Jews were oppressed in Europe and so they said we want to salvage the new Jew, the one who makes the initiatives and plans, grows. And this is how they depicted the early Jews coming here, planting the vacant settlement land to achieve the Zionist dream. And by the way, this phenomena continues in building kibbutzes and within the so-called Green Line and the settlers in the West Bank. It is the same mentality. These are very attractive, and the regular Jew or average Jew believes these to be heroic. This is too much. This is.
هيك كثير. بس يعني ليه طلعت الأرض القاحلة يعني المناسب. الدعاية.
The additional propaganda is that the land, they said the land is not only vacant but also it is arid. I mean, and it is a desert, and you need to make it green. Is one of the Zionist myths that Israel succeeded in promoting through the Jewish National Fund, saying that this is a desert, arid, and we want to make it green. And this propaganda is not as something or something secondary, but this is in the heart, in the core of the literature of Zionist movement. Many scholars and poets wrote about it, that the need for Zionist movement to plant the arid Palestinian territory. Some of the poems were written, and for those who know the literature, there are many famous poets who wrote about this. In light of all of these, there is a Jewish crisis, there is a vacant Jewish land. So the Zionist movement shows itself as the Redeemer, the salvaging one. This was appeared in 1920 in an American Jewish magazine that all these Jews are pouring into Jerusalem and the Israeli flag on one of the domes, mostly the Dome of the Rock or another dome. But this is Jerusalem, and here there is an invitation for Jews to come to this area. So the Jewish person, when he sees this aspiration to access Jerusalem, they will naturally be in solidarity with the Zionist movement. Through the early days of Zionist colonialism in Palestine, they tried to be separate from the Palestinian indigenous people, showing that the Palestinians are backwarded and we need to stay away from them, and we want to build something different here. So they started building an economy, a special economy for them, and promote, like, don't buy from others, only buy from us, from the our agricultural products and the things that we produce. So this, they started building a successful, strong economy, and to convince their audience that we are reclaiming, not destroying, the land. And even today, The cases where Israel builds economic establishments in the West Bank, they use the same thing that we are building. And the Palestinians are benefiting. Rami Levy, the retail supermarket, he says that we hire Palestinians. When someone comes to say that this is a form of settlement, he says, okay, I'm bringing economic benefits to the Palestinians. And this is convincing to those strangers away from Palestine. The National Fund also as a strong tool of the Zionist movement since it was established in 1901. This is the last one. And succeeded in making connection with the spiritual connection between the Jews and the Holy Land and started collecting donations from the average Jews across the world. And during Jewish occasions, asking them to donate in order to invest in the Holy Land. And these boxes, they put it in schools and libraries and markets and in shops. And they started planting woods across Palestine. These woods, they cover hundreds of heritage Palestinian displaced villages. They evacuated the land, they planted these trees. And in order to get solidarity of other nations, Jews and non-Jews, they gave they named these woods after the names of other nations. They call it Canada Park, although Ken Kayemet work here in West Bank since 1967. This is over the Latron area. So they named the woods with the names of other nations and countries. This was started in 1970-71. There's France Park, there's the US Park, the South Africa Park, and so forth. Many woods named after the names of countries. In order to stop believing that they are undefeatable, just to give 2 points. First one, despite what all they did, majority of Jews did not immigrate to Palestine until this day. The majority, or around 50% of Jews, they still live outside Israel. The second thing, when lies are revealed, lies of the National Fund, some breach might be between the Jewish communities and the Jewish National Fund. By the way, in Hebrew, Jewish National Fund, Keren Keyemet Israel, has religious something, that is, the fund to collect the charities to support the needy people, trying to show that Israel needs is in need of your support. This is one of the issues that happened with us during our work in a tour in one of these woods. They discovered that this was wood of named after South Africa, is built over a displaced Palestinian village. So they sent letters to the Jewish National Fund, objecting to abusing them and using their support in a political colonialist thing and taking over human rights, especially that of the Palestinian refugees in the village, Palestinian village of Lubia. Then they made a film about this, and they came to Lubia and apologized to the Palestinian refugees as being used to prevent the return of Palestinian refugees. I stop here. Thank you. Thank you.
يعني الأستاذ عمر فتح ملفات كثيرة
في
فيها حقة
في I don't know the discussion if he can cover he spoke about Zionizing religion
هذه النقطة أصبحت الطريق
and so the road became short to religious Zionism. He spoke about Herzl. There are many research in Israel and outside that spoke about him. He started as a colonialist, not a Zionist in the very meaning of the word. He was not a religious or not from Palestine.
كان يشعر بالنقص إذا
he was feeling inferior to the Germans and in order to be accepted by the Germans he wanted to establish a colony for the Germans abroad and then he took over Palestine. It's good that you use the term the Jewish state because now Israel is discussing well, Herzl's book, is it the Jew's book or the Jewish state? But they say that he meant the Jewish state instead of the state of the Jews. And the comment before the last one is that you spoke about the benefit that the Zionism is doing in the 1967. When Herzl was there, there was an Arab personality, his name is Rashid Beck, receiving the Zionist project, saying that it will bring benefits for the Palestinians. So the inspiration is there. And the last comment, there are many things that can be said, but time is not enough for us. Mr. Omar spoke a lot about Zionist terminology, which is not innocent at all. When he spoke about immigration, in Hebrew, they say, to rise or come up to Israel, not immigration. And when you come to Israel, they say to descend to Israel. Sometimes the number of immigrants was very high. I called them, the descendants are going up. Anyway, now we go to the third intervention. Sorry for the comments, but I needed to say that. Anyway, the third intervention by Mr. Sam Bahour. He's a Palestinian-American business consultant residing in Ramallah. He's one of our old friends,
titled
Visiting Apartheid, Israeli Style.
He
speak about the tours organized by the Zionist movement for the Jews from across the world, especially the younger generation. Mr. Sam, you know that recently there is for support from Jews in America for religious reasons. I'm sure you will shed light on that. Sam will make his presentation in English, and there is an interpretation into Arabic. We have interpretation into Arabic. Thank you, Sam.
جننا كلنا ضبطت تمام very good okay my presentation will be about the use of trips to Israel as a form of solidarity with the state of Israel. This is kind of bringing the discussion up to date. What we heard so far was a foundation of the historic approach to building solidarity. This is as if it's the new version that we're facing today. I won't go through this, but these are the topics that we'll discuss, a few background issues, some cases, and then talking about some of the pushback that's happening. First, we need to look at what are the purposes of trips to Israel. And this is very well documented in the publications. The first purpose of trips is to encourage Jews around the world to relocate to Israel. The second is to mobilize economic support for the state of Israel, regardless of where the person resides. So bringing a person here is not only for them to relocate, but also to support the Israeli state economically and otherwise wherever they are, whether it's Ohio, New York, or Berlin. The third is the Israelis see the visiting tours as a key factor in their tourism economy, and you're going to see this later on as well. First, what are the visits? Are they for pleasure or for politics? When I was preparing for this presentation, I reached out to a Jewish American activist friend of mine who actually established two organizations that work to bring Jewish Americans to Palestine. And one of the things she said was, we want diaspora Jews to support Israel financially, politically, spiritually, and emotionally. So we bring them here to show them beautiful places and dynamic people. Note, it's comprehensive, financial, political, spiritual, and emotional. And the trips are seeing historic sites in the occupied territory, in Israel, in the recreation areas. And this picture here is, yani, it says a lot, because it's the stereotype of the camel, and I don't know what this is, but it shows that it's bringing all different kinds of people, not necessarily for a political trip, but for more of a comprehensive trip. The same friend of mine said that the Jewish educators talk about creating a bubble, and that bubble can be a shared intense experience, whether it's a trip to Israel or Jewish summer camps. And these are the most effective form of Jewish education in terms of building strong ties, a sense of belonging, a sense of commitment. I compare this to, for example, a police force. Once you put on your police uniform or your military uniform or your doctor's jacket, you're part of a community and you start to support that community. And sometimes that support goes out of control and you're supporting that community even when the community is doing something wrong. Also, this Jewish friend noted that the trips are jokingly referred to, but it's not really a joke, for young adults to match up and marry. And these pictures come from the Birthright website, which I'll talk about in a second, but it's being very much promoted. Come on a visit to Israel and you might meet your partner. So again, very much comprehensive, not only strictly political. And I say this because I work a lot with groups that are coming, and there's a heavy orientation to the groups we speak to want them to want to show them all the political aspects of Palestine. And we need to be a little bit more sensitive that the person coming is not a PhD in politics. They also want to see the cultural side of Palestine, the food side of Palestine, etc. There's a book that was written recently called Tours That Bind. It's completely dedicated to the issue of groups coming to visit Israel. And I won't read this, but I listed it in case someone wants to read it later. But these trips can actively position themselves into relation to the state. So now if you come on a trip, your stories, your narrative can always be tied to that location. Also, it's a partnership to systematically develop a tourism as a form of political socialization. So you're bringing people so they can politically align with the state as well. And if we look at where the politics of Israel is today, that alignment can be very destructive. Plus, it's a place engaging practices to shape political identities. This book goes in great detail of how the Israeli organizations or the pro-Israeli organizations don't shy away that ultimately their hidden agenda is to create political identities. The book goes on to say that the tours, and this is a schizophrenia within the book and within the Israeli society, the tours quietly substitute round-trip visits for permanent one-way migration. Come on a trip to see Palestine, to see Israel, but the intention is hopefully you will stay. But at the same time, there's another school of thought within the Zionist organizations which say they use it to sustain the Israeli diaspora, not to eliminate it. They understand that the majority of Jews are not coming to Israel, so they work to sustain the diaspora community in support of Israel. And again, we come back to tourism's deployment as an agent of diaspora building. How do you build your diaspora abroad? You bring them to Israel and create a sense of community from here. And as Omar said, contrary to popular belief, Zionism has failed in its undertaking to attract Jews from around the world to come to Israel. the minority of Jews around the world come to Israel, and it turns out that Israel is one of the least safest places for Jews anywhere in the world. That is an exact opposite of what Herzl wrote in the last page of his book, The Jewish State. Because in the last page, he says, once we create the state of Israel, anti-Semitism will go away and Jews will come to Israel to live. That did not happen. Today's Israel and Zionist leaders understand that demographics is their Achilles heel. We can see in 1947-48, there was migration from Europe, especially after the Holocaust, to Palestine during the British Mandate time. And even if we fast forward till today, this was done par mass, this is being done par family. So when there is a bombing or something in Paris, you'll find the Israeli prime minister going not to give condolences, but to tell French Jews that it's time for you to come to Israel. So it's an ongoing process. And now, with the growing number of lawmakers, legislators around the world questioning Israeli actions toward Palestinians, Israel finds itself in a bind. Not only did they not get all of the Jews to come to Israel, but also now their actions are being contemplated by lawmakers around the world. So basically, to mainstream the state of Israel around the world, Israel partnered with different resources to be able to make destination points happen, whether it's hiking trails, tourism promotion, recreation. All of these are not done by the state itself, nor is it done by organizations themselves. The state has an agenda, and they partner and give interest to organizations so they can do it together. So everyone is aligned, but the agenda is the same. And if we can see for lawmakers, it has the trips for lawmakers, especially from the U.S., has become a ritual that Israel politically milks for the benefit of entrenching their colonial undertaking. In the U.S., there's an organization called American Israel Education Foundation, and most of these organizations have the word education in them. Why? Because they're registered as tax-deductible organizations in the U.S., and you have to be a non-political organization to get that status. So Americans can donate to this organization tax-free to be able to send their lawmakers to meet with Israeli officials. And this has become similar to the trip to Yad Vashem. You come to Israel and see the Holocaust Museum, you come to the cabinet to be able to show your support for Israel. And that's very connected to American domestic politics as well. So what are the different types of visits? And I note here that the types of visits in a broad sense are planned, well-resourced, and marketed. Let me give you a few examples. First, let's note that during the 400 years of the Ottoman time, who on the ground was leading the Palestinian tourism sector? It was Palestinians. They had the labor force that was serving the tourism sector. They were making money from the sector, and they were creating the narrative. The Zionist organization, when the British Mandate started, saw that as a threat because the Palestinians started to give their narrative to visitors that were coming from a Zionist perspective, and that created a controversy. So much so that we need to note that Eastern European pilgrims from the beginning of the 20th century were mainly Catholic and Greek Orthodox pilgrims. That started to change mostly by Protestants coming, and even that became no longer a church-based trip. It became a Zionist traveler trip. And the Zionist organization started to see that tourism could be a useful tool to advance the Zionist cause. And then Zionist organizations started to add tours to their agendas. I put this here because I was fascinated. We're talking about the 1920s and 30s. Some of the references, look at the titles of the documents. Eretz Israel for Jewish Tourists. Travelers in Palestine and Colonialization Problem. Again, as Omar said, they had no problem talking about colonization. Of course not. The UK, the British at the time, had a ministry called the Ministry of Colonial Powers or something like that. So colonization was a clear intention. Zionism, tourism, and the battle for Palestine. Clearly, tourism was the Palestinian role, and Zionism was the new agenda. And they saw it as a battle. The shocking thing here is in 1925, long before the State of Israel was created, The Zionist organization created something called the Zionist Tourist Information Bureau, which was organizing how the agendas of tourists should work. Fascinating planning here. Today, some of the infrastructure that's used for visiting Israel, all of these on the outside of this slide are the Jewish federations, each one with their own logo, but it's one organization at the end of the day, and each one has an agenda. I think this is Minnesota. We have our friends from Minnesota here today. They may know it. Each of these Jewish community relations councils brings groups here. And then you have students coming with the Hillel organization and with the Birthright Israel. You have the JNF, which was spoken about earlier, and I'll get to again. And then you have AIPAC, which brings very politically oriented groups such as congressmen and senators. The trips are also not done only by Zionist or Jewish organizations. They do them in partnership with other organizations to be able to build loyalty. Here you have in Texas a congregation, and they're connecting with a church in Texas to be able to come on an interfaith pilgrimage. Interesting, they're coming to see Israel, and it's clearly an agenda-oriented trip, but they market it with the Dome of the Rock. Nothing about Israel per se. They market it with occupied territory. If we see another trip, type of trip, it's trips that are used for conferences. And this is very, very popular in Israel. And it's also a very easy platform for us to lobby, because as these conferences come to Israel, they are places that we can start challenging. This one is a recent one in July, the Climate Forum in Israel with the State of Israel, very fancy logo, more tourism-oriented than state-oriented. And with some think tanks in Israel, bringing people to talk about Sharm el-Sheikh, in Sharm el-Sheikh, in Tel Aviv, to talk about climate change in preparation for the conference that just happened in Egypt. And then in the first Intifada, the image of Israel got disrupted. All of a sudden, Israel was on the 24/7 nightly news of having an uprising and Israel beating people in the street, and the pictures were not good for tourism. So what did Israel do? They hired a marketing firm, or several, and they came out with a strategy. What was the strategy? Pick locations in Israel and market them as independent destinations. I picked this one because I thought it was amazing. Eilat. Not Eilat Israel, Eilat. Do you see an Israeli flag anywhere? No Israeli flag. Come to Eilat. It's as if it's on the moon, because they wanted to keep supporting the tourism industry even though there was a mess on the ground. So they started to pick specific locations, a brilliant marketing approach if you ask me. A case in point, as was discussed earlier, the Jewish National Fund not only builds parks and forests, they also have a trips agenda. The Jewish National Fund was created by Theodor Herzl. In 2015, it had 950 employees. Today, it has over 1,000. 1,000 employees in a single organization. It's a quasi-government organization because part of its mandate is given to it by the State of Israel, because the Jewish National Fund does things that the State of Israel prefers not to do directly. What do they have on their website? Very quickly. They have a children's program. They have a high school program. They have a college students program. And they have an educators program. They cover the entire life cycle of a person. And this is very comprehensive and important for us to learn from. It's not about bringing a person one time. It's about building a mindset to be able to create support for the State of Israel. And this is the most important, supporting an educators community in the U.S. that knows how to serve these communities from an education perspective. In this approach, you will always see their education is education and advocacy. It's never education for the sake of education. It's always two in one, something to keep in mind. What kind of trips do they bring? Very briefly, very targeted marketing. I'm a marketing expert myself, or marketing person myself, so I understand what's behind this. They have a trip for tour for people over 55 years old. And don't worry, because this one will take you carefully paced trip. So if you're tired, this one will take it slow motion. Then if you're interested in the desert, they have one for going to the south of Israel.
and this one got cut off a little bit, but this one will show you Israel in the winter. Actually, they canceled this. It's not on, probably because the new government got created, and they're probably thinking what to do. Another trip, very marketing-focused. For Canadian Americans, retirees, very, very focused. This is an active retirees. This is not where you just come and go to the hotel and go to the church. This is where you actually go pick things like lemons, active. They have a trip for health professionals. Again, very specific. They have a trip for women. Come and see the women of Israel. Very targeted marketing. They have one for people who are interested in real estate. Can you imagine? They have one to visit the birthday of Israel. This was the 75th birthday coming up. And they have one, like the South, this one will take you to the North, where it's open plains. Again, very specific. Another one for adults, retirees, and another one linking it more to the synagogue's orientation. All of these to make a case that this institution has a very sharp marketing focus, and they're working very professional to create an ongoing support for the State of Israel. The second organization that I would like to point to is the Birthright Organization. Again, I won't go through this. It's a $500 million initiative by private investors, the State of Israel, and diaspora Jewish organizations. They offer students a free 10-day trip to Israel, usually college-age students. They have sent over 200,000 people already. They don't do it by themselves. Again, they partner with 30 different organizations on the ground. They license them. So all of a sudden, this very political agenda is linking to the private sector and giving them interest to support the program. Every trip costs $120,000. This is one organization focused specifically on college students. Very particular. This is a new article. This was out in the 8th of November, a week ago, and it talks about the Birthright Project has saved the Israeli tourism industry. During COVID, during a slowdown, because of what's going on politically as well, the trips bring 200,000 people to Israel. That's 200,000 hotel rooms and meals and so forth. Yossi Beilin, who is supposedly on the left of the Israeli spectrum, is the mind behind Birthright, and that should say a lot. The third and last point here is Mahal. This is the one I like best. Mahal is a website. When you go to it, you think you're on the IDF website. It's all about military. It's all about soldiers. This is a nonprofit, supposedly, organization that actually promotes a separate marketing target audience. That target audience is people who want to come and serve in the IDF. So not every tour is coming to see the tourist sites. There are tours that are coming to occupy us individually. And there's very particular marketing. If you're a Jew coming back to make an aliyah, back to stay here, that's one application. If you're a Jew, which is a Haradi Jew, that's another one. If you're a secular Jew, that's another one. If you're an Israeli citizen overseas, that's another one. Very targeted marketing. And if we come to today, you see that from Russia-occupied Ukraine to Israeli-occupied Palestine. That's what we think. The reality is no. Only out of the 12,000 Ukrainians that came, only 1% ended up in the West Bank. And out of those, half of them live in Male Adumim or Ariel. They didn't go deep into the West Bank. So the settlement project is not a product that is convincing people today to be a location. Israel also, and I'm almost done here, Israel has high-level messaging supporting the tourism sector. Think of the institutional backing here and think of how we approach our tours. I'm not sure the high level in Palestine understands there's even tours happening. What does Israel do with their tours? They take it to the UN. We saw that democracy in action last week. They know their product is spoiled. This is an article that came out last month, And the name of the article is "The Way We Teach Our Kids About Israel Is Broken. Here's How to Fix It." I call this a learning organization. Israel understands it's in a tight spot. This article proves that. They created a new organization called Makom. It's the Israeli Education Lab of the Jewish Agency. This article talks about when students are going to the university system in the US, they're getting shocked because the Palestinian solidarity movement on the ground is introducing them to things they never saw before, things they never heard before, things like the Nakba, things like military occupation. So they created a project called Dreams of Others, and they want to teach Jewish students in the US the Palestinian perspective before they get to the university from a Zionist angle. So an entire organization was created. You can visit their website. And this is where they're going, the place for challenging Israel education. They will give the Palestinian perspective and how to reply to it before the student gets to the university. Lastly, there is pushback. There are Jewish students which are saying, enough of this. We want to return the birthright. We want to give the birthright back to the Palestinians. Those in Ain al-Hilwa, in refugee camps in Lebanon and Syria, they have the birthright to come home, not somebody who doesn't have any connection in their life to Palestine. A recent book came out, Days of Awe, from a friend of mine, Atila Omar. She teaches in the US. It talks entirely about students, Jewish students, coming around to learning what they didn't know and joining the solidarity movement. This is a book worth reading if you're interested in this topic. Lastly, Israel's doing something else in parallel. They're blocking real tourists. In February of this year, they produced a 97-page document. We went to the higher court in Israel and challenged it. They reduced it to a 90-page document. And basically, the message is the same. Do not visit. Restrictions to make sure people cannot reach the occupied territory. I wrote an article recently of what you miss when you come and visit Palestine. It's good to visit Palestine. It's good to visit the occupation. You see the checkpoint. You see the settlers. You can talk to a refugee. But what you can't see is the bulk of what is happening to us administratively and historically. And I point people to this article if they're interested in it. Thank you.
Thank you. Shukran kathir. شكرا كثير مزبوط الموضوع ايضا كمان يعني
thanks a lot this is very interesting and it brings several points that require عن قضية النكبة discuss more you spoke about النكبة this sends me to think and add that since Al-Karama in May 21 uprising there is a new discussion about النكبة
في الحيز العام
in the Israeli general space, public space and by the way this is an opportunity to speak about a new Israeli paper at Madar about al-Nakba titled From Denial to Threatening with a New Nakba Now, there are Israeli rights, they acknowledge al-Nakba for the sake of threatening to repeat it. Some of the speakers of the new right wing, they say Nakba is not a sad event, but rather a happy one, because it ended the Palestinians. Certainly, this requires special attention to know how the Zionism presents its story, not only for the young Jewish or non-Jewish generations, but it is a subject that really requires more coordination. I'm sure, Asma, that in the next conference, maybe next year, Sam, is required to speak to us how Zionism promotes itself for the Arabs in tourism. Now we move to the fourth intervention in this evening. I'm sorry to keep asking you to come to the fourth intervention is by Elisa Wise. Alyssa Wise is a community organizer and organizational steward with over two decades of movement building experience. She was a staff leader at Jewish Voice for Peace, JVP, from 2011 to 2021. She will speak about Christians United for Israel. In fact, this subject is taking a very large space based on my follow-up of the Israeli affairs. It's taking a very large space, and the relation between Israel and Anglicans started after, before the 1967. But the more Israel goes towards the right wing or right side, this relation gets stronger. During Netanyahu time and Trump time, we noticed that this relation even increased so much that when the American embassy was moved from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem and opened there, the majority of people there were from the Anglicans, led by two. First, the former is American ambassador, Ronnie Friedman, who's proposed to be the American foreign minister, and David Friedman, the American ambassador. The earlier one was Ronnie Friedman, the Israeli ambassador to the US. Now, I will give the floor to Alyssa. I'm sure she has a lot to say about this and to explain to us what is the secret behind this strong relation between the Israeli right wing and the Anglican Christians in the United States. The floor is yours, madam.
It's morning for me, but it's evening for you. So good evening. I'm calling in from Philadelphia. I really wish I was there in Palestine with you all next time. I want to be there in person. So I'm going to actually be discussing and touching on a lot of what we heard in little pieces of what each of the prior presenters contributed. So hopefully it'll kind of just add to the conversation. So I'm really glad to be a part of this conversation. And this topic of solidarity comes at a really perfect time for me personally, right? So I am in the midst of writing a book about my decade at Jewish Voice for Peace. The book, God willing, will come out in 2024 from Haymarket. So you can look for that. And part of the question that we are looking at in the book that we're writing is exactly what we mean by solidarity and how exactly Jewish solidarity with Palestinians has looked, should look, and could look. So for me, as a Jewish person who identifies as being in solidarity with the Palestinian people, I understand that this is not a selfless effort, right? As sometimes solidarity is understood. Of course, the primary reason I dedicate my life to fighting for Palestinian freedom is because of what that means for Palestinians. And at the same time, I also am clear that I have a lot to gain from the ending of Zionism. The world I want to live in is not a world where Palestinians or anyone is forced to live under apartheid with all of the violence and cruelty and indignity that entails. Apartheid makes me less safe, right? And also, I have a vision and a longing for a Jewish life beyond and without Zionism. So I wonder, like, does the fact that I understand that I have something to gain undermine or enhance my solidarity? So from what I understand, this Mapping Unsolidarity project that you all are exploring kind of is complicating the question of solidarity, which I really value, right? And solidarity is often associated with the left, but solidarity is in fact value neutral, right? It's something that not only those concerned with human rights or justice can engage in. It's an act that all people can participate in, whether on the left or the right or in between. And we see the way right-wing governments worldwide are in alliance or solidarity with each other. And it's not just governments, but also social movements. For instance, Christian Zionism. So today, Christian Zionism in the United States is arguably the largest social movement here. Some date the beginning of the alliance between the Israeli government and the Christian Zionist movement to the 1970s, when the Moral Majority was founded, right, in 1979. And throughout the 1980s, the Moral Majority, which was a right-wing Christian evangelical organization closely linked with the Republican Party, gained steam in prominence, right, and led to the elections of several Republican presidencies throughout the 80s into the 90s. At the center of their ideology is the Christian theology of dispensationalism, which sees history through a series of dispensations or eras appointed by God. And according to this theology, we are now in the era of end times, right? The last dispensation of the Christian book of Revelation. So according to their beliefs, in order for the second coming of the Messiah to take place, there must be a Jewish state in historic Palestine. This is the root for the Christian movement in solidarity with Israel. And it dates way back before the 1970s. And in many ways is why the state of Israel exists in the first place, I want to argue. So in some ways, Christian solidarity with Israel began before Israel did. The solidarity included shaping the narrative for the need for Israel, promoting policies that at least ostensibly benefit Israel, and enabling and encouraging Israel's maintenance as a Jewish state at the expense of Palestinians. The story begins in earnest in the mid-19th century as dispensationalism is growing as a dominant theology, though it had been around for a few centuries by then. It is then that a phrase which remains all too common, given the lie at its core, is born. That phrase, which a lot of you have heard, and I think it's been mentioned through some of these comments, or at least alluded to for the other presentations, a land without a people for a people without a land, right? We've heard that phrase. And I always imagined that this came out of the mouth of Jews, but that's not the case. Its earliest published use was in the 1843 in a book by a Scottish clergyman, Alexander Keith, in a book called The Land of Israel, According to the Covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. So 1843, which predates the rise of the political Zionist movement, the Jewish element of the political Zionist movement. Keith was an adherent to the belief that Jewish settlement in historic Palestine is a prerequisite for the second coming of Christ. In his speeches and talks, he would advocate for the idea that Christians should work to encourage the biblical prophecy of a Jewish return to the land of Israel, saying, "A people without a country, even as their own land, as subsequently to be shown, is in great measure a country without a people," right? This relates to the images that were shown earlier, right, of the reality of Palestinian cities and villages and the cartoon of it vacant, right? He did know that what he was saying was a lie. He had traveled to Palestine in 1839, right? 4 years before coming up with this, a land without a people for a people without a land. And he visited again 5 years later. The phrase continued to be used in Presbyterian publications throughout the latter half of the 19th century in various formulations, such as, "Surely the land without a people and the people without a land are intended soon to meet and mutually possess each other." Or in 1858, a Scottish Presbyterian advocated the repatriation of Israel, in which we have a people without a country, as well as a country without a people. Interestingly, right, and this is like, I've been really interested, and I feel like as a Jewish American, right, kind of understanding the way that US support for Israel works is kind of understanding the roots of Christian Zionism. And so in my research, I found that actually, this land without a people myth that it's now perceived as out of the mouth of Jews and definitely was adopted by Jews, initially was rejected by it. So in a German paper, the most prestigious German Zionist, pro-Zionist paper in Germany in August 1925, they wrote, "We may be a people without a home, but alas, there is not a country without a people. Palestine has an existing population of 700,000. So it's actually really interesting that they knew, right? Likewise, Theodore Herzl, the leader, right, who we've talked about today, acknowledges the resident population of Palestine, but still in the messaging and the marketing of this idea of the Jewish state, that truth gets peppered over. So this deceitful phrase nonetheless becomes a tool of solidarity for Christian Zionists with Israel. It became the mantra of a mythology that undergirds Israel's settler colonial project, a phrase that seeks to provide moral cover for those who advocate for a settlement in Palestine, knowing full well that the land is not empty and that settlement would require mass dispossession and exile for the native population and a regime of domination that continue over 70 years later. So solidarity manifests in this example as a PR strategy, a savvy way to market your message, a cover that is given for unjust ends, to make it righteous, to make it virtuous, to make it even sacred. So what was a theological idea circulating in Christian circles quickly turned into a matter of policy, as the white Christian men who led the powerful nations of the world, particularly then dominant United Kingdom, were parishioners at the churches of the Christian Zionist leaders and became believers in this dispensationalist theology. And we all know what happens, right, when these two things come together, right? So arguably the most famous and influential and forwarding Jewish settlement in historic Palestine was a Christian Zionist himself, Lord Balfour, right? So Lord Balfour is the man behind the Balfour Declaration, right? Which we talked, another panelist spoke about him, right? The statement issued by the British government in 1917, announcing support for the establishment of a, quote, national home for the Jewish people in Palestine. So this document was not something that Balfour just one day came up with out of his own. And a lot of historians maintain that there was an effort over not just decades, right, to realize and promote this idea of Jewish settlement in Palestine, which must be nurtured as a matter of foreign policy in order to hasten the second coming, which is a matter of theology. So post-World War I, and in the wake of the Balfour Declaration, popular support greatly increased for Zionism within Jewish communities worldwide. And the Balfour Declaration became the core component, right, of the British mandate for Palestine. So the idea was, of course, also exported to the US, right? And it continues to animate, if not dominate, US foreign policy to this day. The foundational dispensationalist theology of the 19th century influential Christian Zionist voices endure today, which then has been augmented by a post-Nazi Holocaust version that elevates Israel as an exceptional power that Christians must support as God's agent. So as an answer to the Holocaust, it elevates and creates an exceptionalism for Israel, in addition to this mandate to realize the rapture, right, and the second coming. And so this too becomes a manifestation of solidarity. And this Christian theology tethers to settler colonialism is longstanding, right? So this week in the US, it's very much on our minds as the holiday of Thanksgiving is coming on Thursday, right? And this holiday spins a web of lies about the relationship between the indigenous population of the US and the European settlers that came to fulfill what they refer to as manifest destiny, a phrase coined in 1845, notably the same time as the land without a people myth, is the idea that the United States is destined by God to expand its dominion and spread democracy and capitalism across the entire North American continent. This Christian theological colonialism and the instrumentation of the state and governments by white Christian men continues to be an animating force in US politics and US foreign policy, including on Israel. So today in the US, the Christian Zionist lobby is in the form of the organization Christians United for Israel, the acronym CUFI, is the largest pro-Israel organization in the US by far. So its membership, the membership of CUFI, is larger than the entire population of Jews in the United States. There are roughly 7.5 million Jews in the US, and CUFI claims over 10 million members. The organization is just 12 years old, begun in 2010, and its first policy priority back then was passing legislation around Iran and the Iran Sanctions Act. They then went on to skyrocket from 3 million members in 2016 to 10 million members today, thanks to, of course, the Trump administration and Vice President Mike Pence and Secretary of State Mike Pompeo under Trump, who are CUFI members and boosters. So as we know, Trump's era represented the consolidation of Christian Zionist influence and made it more visible and central than it ever was before in our lifetimes. Secretary of State Pompeo, himself a devout evangelical Christian and CUFI member, made his positions of faith clear as he bulldozed one anti-Palestinian policy after another. Right, so the move of the embassy, which we mentioned before, to Jerusalem, at which Pastor John Hagee, the leader of CUFI, offered the official benediction. And this move was a policy priority for CUFI, not for Jewish pro-Israel advocates, as they saw the capital of Jerusalem being established as part of the broader vision for Jewish settlement in the land to hasten the Messianic period. In 2018, CUFI was responsible for the backing of the Taylor Force Act, restricting money to the Palestinian Authority, and also the Stop Using Human Shields Act, targeting Hamas and Hezbollah. So the Trump years were a time of intense growth and success for CUFI, revealing that much of the influence in DC for the blank check for Israel that they get year after year is being championed by Democrats and Republicans alike, but is bankrolled and run by the Christian Zionist lobby. This solidarity with Israel's colonial regime is far-reaching, manipulating vast sums of money and resources while seeking to provide moral cover for Israel's oppressive policies, which undermine Palestinian rights at every level. This solidarity has of late invested in a profoundly sinister tactic to maintain the Zionist regime's hold on Jewish state. They are willing to jeopardize the safety and well-being of Jews everywhere in service of Zionism. This is yet another victory that CUFI claims. The executive order in 2019 that officially adopted the IHRA definition of anti-Semitism that dangerously conflates anti-Zionism and anti-Semitism. This definition, IHRA, which stands for the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, is billed as a way to show solidarity with Jews, but it's actually a profoundly cynical tool for showing solidarity with Zionism. The IHRA definition was originally drafted at the urging of US-based organizations such as the ADL, the American Jewish Committee, and the Simon Wiesenthal Center, in the wake of the debates around Zionism as racism at the UN Conference on Racism in Durban in 2001. Coming out of that conference, the claims by Israel and its allies of racism in the form of anti-Semitism led a group of European countries to come together to define anti-Semitism, with a final draft appearing first in 2005 by the European Monitoring Center on Racism and Xenophobia. The logic at the core of the definition's examples, which are the problem, the definition itself is like 18 words and offers little, but they may, underneath, they have a series of examples, right, which become the crux of the definition. So the definition, those examples, not all of them, but a number of them, equate anti-Zionism as anti-Semitism. So, and in Europe, the history and the lingering guilt after the Nazi Holocaust is part of how Israel's enablers and defenders have been so successful in forwarding the definition. For the past number of years, getting universities, state governments, federal governments in the US to adopt this definition has become a centerpiece of CUFI's lobbying platform in DC. The ironing of this supposed solidarity with Jewish people would be laughable if it was not so deadly. Even as they espouse patently anti-Semitic statements, such as maintaining that Christians must embrace Jews settling in historic Palestine to hasten the second coming, at which point Jews must convert or die. There's hardly a more anti-Semitic notion than that. They claim fighting anti-Semitism in the form of advocacy for Palestinian rights. So this is what solidarity has come to look like. Here in the US, we are experiencing a rise of right-wing anti-Semitism unparalleled in my lifetime by those who look to Nazis as their heroes. And millions of Jews are willing to look the other way if the other side of that Nazi's belief includes support for Israel. They mistake their hatred for solidarity. Or maybe I'm the one to mistake solidarity. Christian Zionist cynical, deceitful PR slogans, networks of high-powered politicians fulfilling their own worldviews and beliefs through policy setting, manipulating historical oppression to shield contemporary oppression. It's leveraging its whiteness, violence, and power. If this is solidarity, I don't want it. Instead, I challenge all of us to find ways to rise together for ourselves and for each other through collaborations with human rights at the center, consensus building for the long-haul policy shifts that we need, with Palestinians at the center of shaping the contours of their own liberated future. We need to take direct actions together to stop the immediate violence happening now and allow art and creativity to be brought to the challenge of articulating a vision of a world redeemed. Thank you to the Katan Foundation for making space where that possibility of solidarity or whatever it is we want to call it can thrive. Thank you.
شكرا جزيلا اخت اليسا. شكرا. فقط يعني نقطتين تقريبا على ما قالته. اولا يعني في اسرائيل هناك ادراك ان الصهاينة المسيحيين باتوا يشكلون العمود الفقري لدعم اسرائيل حتى من الجاليات اليهودية. يعني يعني انا اشرت الى رون دريمن وهذا ما اعترف به. رون دريمن قال لصحيفة نيويورك تايمز ان المسيحيين المتدينين اصبحوا العمود الفقري for the US support to Israel. إسرائيل. والحديث يدور حول ربع ثابت من السكان، وقد يكون ذلك أكبر بـ 10 أو 20 أو 30 مرة من عدد السكان اليهود. 20 or 30 falls of the Jewish population. Also here when we speak about the Anglicans, we need to include not only the Anglicans in the United States, but also the Anglicans across the world. And this is an issue by itself because the Anglican Christians in solidarity with Israel are across the world and they really constitute something that is can be considered as support for the Israeli policy. Thanks for all the
قدموا مداخلات. يعني أنا
speakers.
متعاطف معكم إن
I really feel وقت محدود that the time was limited and should have been longer because subjects require longer time than the given one.
الذي أتيح لكم سنفتح Now we'll open the floor
for some discussion
أو لبعض الأسئلة أو and, لبعض الإضافات
comments
يعني by the present here هنا. وأيضا عندنا حدا بالزوم.
We have someone in Zoom. Do we?
إذا في حدا
anyone would like to add to comment intervene
بحب يوجه سؤال
to ask a question the floor is open.
أقنعناك يعني.
We have convinced you it seems.
طيب.
Okay great.
شكرا
Thank
جزيلا.
You. Just a concluding remark. If you allow me, as conclusion.
بدي أبعد شوي عن الموضوع.
I will stay away from the subject of the intervention. The issue is related to the concept of solidarity. In my belief, there is a major issue. Today, solidarity became.
بيعتبر
that now the Palestinians are considered as subject to this solidarity and that the issue has some empathy with the Palestinian or let's see some commitment to international standards. But solidarity is awareness of the common battle against Israel being an imperialist entity. Then here it becomes the battle of the black because solidarity usually the marginalized are absent such as the Jews.
سوري ذا بلاك
بعتقد هم اقرب الي في خندق التضامن
هو ار ذا موست تو بي فاوند ذس دزنت مين اذرز ويل نوت بي ذير
هم اعماله مش مهمه الدول دائما احنا بنحكي عن التضامن
when we speak you speak about solidarity all the time we'll be looking at Europe and America and what breakthrough we are going to achieve there
بس كمان المعركة المشتركة مع ناس من العالم الثالث مع تركيا مع
Africa, Asia
هناك المعركة
the battle is there it's reality against this imperialist thing called Israel. And the final thing to conclude with, without
basing
on a real resistance project on the ground, Israel cannot be ended with solidarity. Solidarity is something secondary or support.
Supported.
But sometimes we need to have solidarity with ourselves. We don't see this problem
اليوم احنا لهالدرجه عايشين مع separate
from each other that we define
معركتنا المشتركه كمان بتل
السوليداريتي وذ اور بيبل ان جنين
مع اهلنا في
نابلس مع اخواننا از سوليداريتي وذ اور اون برذر
بشوف قديش انه هذا الفعل شوي
how much this action is losing its momentum maybe we need to reconsider it once again thank you
شكرا جزيلا
ملاحظة مهمة
An important يعني comment.
شكرا على الملاحظة طبعا يعني هذا
this
موضوع
subject, this is a subject for another event but to conclude with
إنه فيما يتعلق
as for Israel in particular
يعني دول العالم الأول
first world countries and the US are the fields for that because I believe
مواجهة
facing Israel will not happen unless Israel receives a shock and I don't say this alone but many Israelis say this and the last one who wrote about this is a lawyer wrote in Haaretz Yossi Bilin and also Professor Zeev Stern mentioned this who specialized in fascism Rovi Avneri wrote about this that Israel without this international support cannot be stopped. Solidarity is important and the support of the first world, the problem will remain. That before we, and I always like to end with this, before ask about what others are doing to us, we need to ask what we are doing to ourselves. How we can fight this battle to get more support and lobbying that can lead to results. Thanks, Mikhail Daoudi and Mr. Omar Bari and Samahur and for Elissa. And thanks for the Katan Foundation and thank you.